Praise God Fellowship. Very rarely do we have this, the Sunset Fellowship on a lesson, on a day where there's a lesson. I hate to turn the camera around because this is the part of Sunset where the clouds start changing pink and all kinds of things. So right, for right now, I'm gonna keep the camera on the beautiful sunset that we see going on right now, today's lesson. And you see today's lesson, actually I talked about this in past lessons, but I keep having to pray with people about this same issue. You see the lesson says, Kingdom Business, Church Hurt. Now the whole title is Church Hurt Protection. I didn't have room on the title that you see on the screen, but when you go to the actual YouTube site, it says Church Hurt Protection. And as I say in many lessons past, this lesson is not about all of us telling all the ways we've been hurt. This lesson is about how to keep that hurt from not only stealing your joy, but some people actually give up on God because of what some person did in church at the house of God that made them not just turn away from church, but even give up on God. That's what I mean. We must learn to have church hurt protection. Because there's going to be people in the world who go to church for different reasons. And remember, the body of Christ is really the church. Let me always make that clear so everybody who doesn't understand that. The body of Christ is really what's called the church. The church building is really called the house of God. We keep saying, I go to church every week. Where you go to is the house of God every week. But the body of Christ is the church. For right now, we in the fellowship together, we're the church on the fellowship. Wherever the people are, that's the church who's worshiping, praising, and giving God the glory. The people are the church, and the building is the house of God. Now, where the church hurt we're talking about mainly is taking place in the house of God. When people go into the house of God, and it's supposed to be the same love we feel in fellowship anywhere else. But for some reason in different places, people get egotistical and bring the world into a churchly position. You should feel as much love in the house of God as you feel in fellowshipping with the saints. But when you go into the house of God and you feel politics and you feel hate, you feel jealousy and you feel backstabbing, somehow the world has worked its way in to the house of God and brought ill feelings and competition and backstabbing and gossip into the house of God, where we should be feeling peace beyond understanding. We should be feeling more peaceful in the house of God, not being leery of going into the house of God, worrying about who's gonna lie on you, who's gonna cheat on you. I pray for so many people that cannot, for whatever reason, go back to church because of what's happened to them in all kinds of ways. And like I said, this fellowship lesson today is not about listing what happened, because that could be a lesson all by itself. The testimonies I've heard from people to have me pray for them, even before the fellowship started, one of the most common prayers, if it wasn't marriage problems, the second most common prayer request is help me heal. Help me heal from church hurt. Something someone did to me in the house of God that turned me away from going to the house of God every week. That's one of the most common prayers off of going out, away from fellowship, that I have to pray for. Now, one of the things I want to, the scripture this is based on, turn to Jeremiah 23. Sister John, I used to fellowship at the church where a lot of things were just seemed to be kind of going crazy, and it seemed like people were leaving the church for different reasons, and people were getting upset. And you may be have witnessed this at different churches yourself, where you see behavior in leadership and you go, what's going on here? How can they get away with this? And people are leaving the church left and right. Now, I used to get upset about that until I found this chapter. I used to get upset. How come this, God's letting that happen? How can that person be in leadership? How can they do this? How can they do that? I would get so upset about certain behavior I've seen in leadership in different churches, and people are leaving the church because of that behavior, yet that person is still in position. Until I found this verse, Look at Jeremiah chapter 23. Jeremiah, that's the text for today. Jeremiah 23, verses 1 through 4. Verse 1. Woe to the shepherds who are destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Now right there, well, let me stop right there. Whenever the Lord says, woe, you know somebody's in serious trouble. Whenever God says, woe to this, woe to that, that means you're in a heap of trouble. Just like when you used to be a kid and you'd hear, wait until your father gets home, wait till your mother gets home. Well, let's look at that. When God says, woe to the shepherds who are destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Verse 2, therefore, thus says the Lord, God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who are tending my sheep, my people, you have scattered my flock and driven them away and have not attended to them. Behold, I am about to attend to you for the evil of your deeds, declares the Lord. Whoa, stop right there. Now, wait a minute. This is why I lost all anger. These verses right here let me understand that no kind of misbehavior we see behind the pulpit or any leadership is getting away with any of that behavior. If they're chasing people away from the house of God because of ungodly behavior, both of these verses, first one said, woe to the shepherds who destroy my sheep. And then the second verse says, this is thus says the Lord, I will tend to you. Now, I don't know about you. I would want anybody to tend to me except the Lord. If God says, I will tend to you for the evil of your deeds. Woo! That's like God saying, vengeance is mine. Because when God says, I will tend to you, you know some serious throwdowns coming down in the spirit, however God does it. Because when God moves against the wicked, you got a serious hurt coming. Amen. Verse 3. Now, after he does that, after he tends them, verse 3, then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of the countries where I have driven them and bring them back to the pasture, and they will be fruitful and multiply. Verse 4, I will also raise up shepherds over them, and they will tend them, and they will not be afraid any longer, nor be terrified, nor will any be missing, declares the Lord. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Now see, these verses right here is what calmed my anger whenever I was in the house of God's, where I saw ungodly behavior among the leadership or different things going on in the church that were allowed to happen. I let it for many times steal my joy because I was so upset thinking they were getting away with it. I don't know what I was thinking. God sees everything. God sees everything. God doesn't miss a trick. So if somebody thinks they're misusing people of God and they're going to get away with it, when Saul back in the Old Testament, touch not my anointed. Now, in this case, the anointed are the people of God being abused by leadership. Because remember, you're coming into the house of God to receive his anointing, to be blessed and guided however you're trying to get healing for your life. And if you're getting hurt in the house of God where you're coming to receive healing, they got a serious repercussion coming, because you're supposed to be able to come into the house of God and feel his love, feel his healing. Just like when we finish the stillness, when you come out of the house of God on Sundays, you should feel overjoyed. You should feel rejuvenated. You should feel on fire. Just like we're on fire every day in fellowship, you should feel the fire of the Holy Spirit. If you come out of church because you hate to go in there because I wonder who I got to run into today, I wonder what they're going to say to me today, you know what, maybe I don't go to church today because I don't want to see that person, you're now letting that person block the word meant for you, because that person who has let the devil come in, remember, the devil isn't afraid of church. The devil used to be a praise angel. He has no problem going into church and jumping in somebody, because not everybody's going to church for the word of God. Some people go into church looking for a husband. Some people go into church looking for a wife. Some people go into church just to see who's going. Some people don't even go to the house of God looking for the word. They're going for every reason except the word of God. So you got to be prepared when you're in the house of God. You got to stay prayed up in the house of God as much as you are in the world, because the devil could be sitting right next to you in the pew trying to steal your joy, distract you, and have you miss the sermon that's meant for you by talking to you, whispering to you, doing something distracting, seducing you with wearing some kind of outfit that's lustful, anything he can to steal your attention and joy in the house of God to distract you. So we got to go in the house of God as prayed up as when we go to work. See, the problem is we think we don't have to worry about that in the house of God, but we do, because when people go into the house of God, make sure I turn the car on. When we go into the house of God, the reason church hurt takes place is because so many times we don't expect to be hurt in church. We don't expect to be backstabbed. We don't expect to be lied on. We don't expect people to act worldly in the house of God, but they do. And that leaves us wide open to a blind side to be hurt, because we don't expect that behavior. It's just like family hurt, same thing. Family hurt, church hurt. When you get hurt by somebody in a place where you least expect it, you're blindsided by the hurt because you don't expect that behavior in the house of God. And that's why it's such a surprise. So this lesson is about protecting that, protecting your joy. And how do you protect it? Believe it or not, you pray up before you walk into the house of God, just like you pray up before you go to work in the week, whenever, because you don't know who's in the house of God this week. There are a lot of visitors, and some of those visitors may be ungodly, who are sent by the devil to distract you so that you miss the word in a sermon that's meant for you that day, or to steal your joy, or to make you upset, to not want to come back next week, because that is the purpose they're sent. So when we're going to protect, we're protecting ourselves from church hurt. We have to keep the spirit of discernment turned on, pray up before we go in there, and understand that the enemy can be working in the service as much as in the world. And that's how we protect ourselves. And then don't let the frustration, if we see behavior in leadership or in church rules, or who's allowed to be a member, or we see all kinds of things happening that really disturbs you. Some people have said, there are many churches, there are many house of gods to visit. If the church or house of God, I wanna make sure I keep saying house of God, because right now we're talking about house of gods. If the house of God where you attend is constantly making you dread going there weekly, dread who might come up to you and speak venom to you in the house of God, if that's a place where you dread going every Sunday, guess what? It's time to look for a new house of God. That house of God will fall under the repercussions of these scriptures. If people are dreading to go into the house of God because of manly behavior or misconduct or disrespect or venom, whatever ungodly behavior in the house of God, they're going to reap what they sow. I guarantee they're going to reap what they sow, as we just read in Jeremiah 23. But I'm trying to get you to understand, don't let it steal your joy for seeking the Lord, to seeking fellowship with fellow lovers of Christ. That's the one that I try to pray for people the most. When there's church hurt, don't let it steal your love for the Lord. Don't let it steal your joy and your peace, and the fact that you want to be in the presence of the Lord in the house of God. That means it's time for you to visit other places. And before I joined the church where I am now, I visited different churches for about a year, different churches every week. And just to find out, I said, Lord, you will tell me which church to join. So I went to some churches, had no music. You know me, I'm a musician, so I gotta have music. So I went to a church that had no music whatsoever, didn't believe in music. So obviously that church went off my list. So basically I just went from church to church, visiting, What people did I feel warmth from? What churches had good messages? What churches are feeding what you need? Some people need more praise. Some people want more teaching. Whatever the personal reason you go to the house of God, that must be fed. If you're going into the house of God and you come out hungry for the word, guess what? You didn't get fed. That means you're in the wrong place. The house of God should feed you with the word. You should come out filled with the joy of the Lord. Praise should be in your heart. Come out singing in joy of the Lord and dancing and shouting and ready to attack the weak. If you come out of the house of God depressed, you are in the wrong place. And then we just pray to the Lord, Lord, guide me. Guide me to a house of God that gives me what I need to be closer to you. You may have a lot of friends in that church, but you also have a lot of people who cause church hurt. That's still, even if you have a lot of friends, if that is keeping you from feeling the joy of the Lord, you are in the wrong place. You know what you need when you go to the house of God. You know what you're seeking. You got to be able to feel that you don't need to have a shield around you. If you go into the house of God feeling you got to keep a shield up, worrying about being backstabbed, talked about, lied about, gossiped about, people gonna talk to you, talk down to you, leadership looks at you like you're crazy, you are in the wrong place. Not give up on God, just go to a different house of God that will give you the peace you need, the joy you need. That's how we pick where we go every Sunday, to the house of God, by letting it feed what it is you need spiritually. So many people just go to church for the wrong reasons. Like I said earlier, if you're going to church looking for social life, you're going to church to see what famous celebrities are there, you're going to church just to look for a husband or wife, you're not going there for the right reason. So the devil's going to have a field day with you because you're not going into the house of God with the right preparation, seeking his word, seeking his will, seeking what it is he wants to fill you with. That's why we go every Sunday, to get fed. You go to the restaurant, you're expecting to get fed. If you're in the wrong church, that's like going to a restaurant and the waiter never comes with your food and you leave the restaurant hungry. That's exactly what it's like. When you're in the wrong house of God, you come out of the restaurant hungry because you never got fed. You came to get fed, to feel God's peace, God's love, and the word for you coming from the sermon that you can apply to your life. If you come out hungry and don't even know what was talked about, that's how you need to evaluate where it is, as far as, is it filling your spiritual need? And that's why this lesson is so important today. Even though I've talked about church hurt in the past in a different way, because of various people I prayed for just even this past week that were just so hurt that they almost turned against God. I've actually had a few people who did turn against God because they thought, if God lets that happen, what kind of God are they serving? And they let that behavior turn their love for the Lord around because they looked at the behavior as being God's fault, not the person's whose behavior chased them away. So this is what we want to make sure we share with people, whoever we come in contact with, who's going through a frustration of church hurt, or feel that someone backstabbed them or lied on them at church, and they're really upset at church, and they don't want to go to church anymore because of what happened. Just tell them it's not the right place. If that's where you're going, and you're coming out feeling angry and no joy whatsoever, it's time to start visiting different places and pray to the Holy Spirit to guide you to the right place, to let you know when to stand up and join. The Holy Spirit will always, I whittled it down to two churches in my 1 hour search, my 1 year search for the house of God that I wanted to attend. And I finally dwindled it down to two churches, and I went back and forth. And I finally said, Holy Spirit, whichever one you have me stand up, that's the one I'm going to join. And now it's been 30 years I've been at that church because the Holy Spirit let me know which one is the one I should be attending. And that's how we should approach whatever house of God we join. Just don't join quickly. Let the Holy Spirit let you know if this is the church, house of God, that you should join, and the Holy Spirit will let you know. And by joining in that way and letting the Holy Spirit guide you, that will help protect you from the venomous personalities that may be in different house of gods, because you aren't praying for the guidance in that way, to be led in that way. So that's why you're doing that, because you're seeking that direction in order to be able to prevent that kind of thing from happening. So that's why we do this. And that's how we always let the Holy Spirit guide us in every way. In every way. We always say, in every way, have your way. In every way, have your way, Holy Spirit, in every part of our life. And that's what I want to leave you guys with tonight. Tonight's message is it, the Holy Spirit laid it on my spirit, because of the number of people I've been praying for online and a few people offline. And it keeps coming back, this same issue. And we've got to learn to understand that the devil will try to attack us anywhere, at home, our family, at work, in the house of God, wherever he can. And we must understand that whenever someone is attacking us, it's not them attacking us, it's the demon speaking through them and using them to attack us. Remember, it's none of this is personal. The warfare is not carnal. Everything we always talk about every attack, is about the warfare is not carnal, a spiritual battle going on. The devil does not want any of us to have the joy of the Lord and to love the Lord and to have faith in the Lord. He wants to steal whatever he can to get us to take our mind and spirit and love off the Lord. Praise God, Vera. Amen. Amen. We're stealing the message, Vera. Welcome. So that is why we have to stay focused everywhere. Everywhere we have to keep on the whole armor of God. It goes, especially family reunions. I mean, we did a lesson on that way last year. Family hurt. You got to keep your hedge of protection, the whole armor of God, on 24/7, because you never know who the devil's going to try to come through. And we never want to be blindsided, because we know the devil comes to steal, kill, destroy. He's just doing what he does best. But we also know that we're ready to stand against all the wiles, all the schemes, all the darts of the devil, when we have the whole armor of God on, and knowing this fight not against just flesh and blood, but it's a bigger fight going on, principalities and spiritual warfare. And that's why I named this fellowship Mighty Warriors for Christ. We're not just here having a social gathering, we're here preparing ourselves for battle every day, because every day we walk out that door, we are in a battle to keep our peace, to keep our joy, to keep our faith, to hold on to God's unchanging hand. Every day we wake up, that battle takes place. That's why I spend 30 minutes every day praising God to get us fired up, because the devil's going to try something every day. That's his job. But every day, as soon as we open our eyes, praise God, thank you, Jesus, for another day. And we start praising God as soon as we open our eyes, not just on fellowship, wherever you are, give thanks. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Because that is the key. That is the key to be able to not only protect ourselves against church hurt, but against any kind of hurt, friends, family, co-workers, strangers, just to know that we got the whole armor of God on every day. Psalm 91 protection every day. Ready to use our authority every day. These are the weapons we've been given. The authority to be able to trample over what? All the power of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt us when we remember to use our authority. Don't walk around and go through all this craziness. Don't put up all this craziness you don't have to put up with. Use that authority in the name of Jesus. Cast that thing out of your presence. In the name of Jesus, it's got to go. In the name of Jesus, claim it. Whatever it is, use that authority. In the name of Jesus, he said, I go to the Father that the Father may be glorified. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. And then he repeats himself, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Remember who we are in Christ. Remember who we are in Christ and to never stop walking in our authority. Amen. Amen. Please remain silent for the binding, loosing prayer right now. Father God, right now, Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we bind every spirit of retribution, revenge, retaliation against any demonic attack on any fellowship member because of their participation in this fellowship. In the name of Jesus, we bind every spirit of retribution, revenge, retaliation, backlash, and every other demonic spirit, named, unnamed, seen, unseen, and cast you all out of our mind, out of our spirit, out of our presence, out of our family, out of our homes, back to the pit of hell from whence you all came. And Father God, loose right now, Lord, loose into the fellowship in the name of Jesus. Loose peace beyond understanding. Loose restoration. Restore, 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 Lord, every area of our life. Lord, loose reconciliation. Heal marriages and family disputes, Lord. Heal family and marriage disputes right now, Lord, in Jesus' name. Heal them right now. And please, Lord, continue to protect all the families and marriages who are not falling apart, but who the devil still attacks every day. Lord, loose supernatural healing. By your stripes, we are healed. We are healed. We are healed. Lord, and we claim healing every single day, Lord. We speak healing every day. We receive healing every day, Lord, because by your stripes, we are healed. And we use our authority every day to speak healing, emotional healing, physical healing, Lord, in every way, Lord. Have your way. Father God, loose supernatural overflow, abundance, financial breakthrough, supernatural debt cancellation. Let your blessings of abundance rain down on the fellowship right now, Lord. Rain down. You shall supply all our need according to your riches in glory by Christ Jesus. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I shall not want for anything when the Lord is my shepherd. And Father God, loose especially our miracle, Lord. Every fellowship member has been praying for a miracle. We take the time every day, Lord, to see the miracle, to believe the miracle, to receive the miracle into our heart. And once we receive it to our heart, we start expecting the miracle. And by faith, Lord, we start walking in the miracle even before it manifests in the flesh, because we know, thank you, Jesus, we know the miracle is already finished. It's already done. It is already on the way. We don't know the when, but we know that miracle is already on the way. And we don't lose heart. Like the word says, we will reap if we faint not. And Father God, we don't get weary, but we know that miracle, it can happen any day we wake up. Could be the day of the manifestation of our miracle. All these things we ask, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name we pray in agreement. Amen. Amen. Amen.